Please join me in welcoming Bruce Pogoski.
Thanks. Good afternoon, everybody. How are you doing? If you're into it, just turn around, look at the cameras, and don't get on here so you can tell your bosses you were actually here at this event. And Steve, thanks for the nice introduction. Really appreciate that. But I'm going to tell people how I really happened to get here. Renee Osborne got together with a group of people, a committee, and they were deciding what to do for your day. And someone on the committee said, let's do something different. Let's bring in a motivational speaker. And someone on that committee said, whoa, here, hold on. I've heard some of these motivational speakers. And if we're going to get one, let's make sure we get the best one we can possibly find. So they put a list together, went right to the top of the list, and they called that person up and said, can you please come speak in Ashland? And the boy said, I'd love to do that, but I can't. So they couldn't get the best motivational speaker for him. And someone said, let's do this. Let's get someone that knows the most about motivation, a real scholar on the subject, someone that can teach us things we can use with our kids and on the golf course and with our clients, someone that knows everything about motivation. Well, they didn't just do call. They called that person, saying, can you please come speak in Ashland? And the voice said, I'd love to do that, but I can't. So they couldn't get the best motivational speaker, the person that knew the most about motivation. And finally, someone just said, let's do this. Let's get someone that's so warm and has such a great personality that they'll fill that room with warmth and no one's really going to care what they're talking about. Maybe they'll get done early, and that would be fantastic. They didn't just do a call. They called that person, said, could you please come speak in Ashland? And the voice said, I'd love to do that, but I can't. I think it was about, 2 weeks ago, I got a call in my office from Renee. She said, Bruce, I'm really in a bind here in Ashland. And we need someone to come speak to our safety council. Can you please find it in your heart to do that? And I started thinking to myself, you know, how could I possibly say no to this lady 4 times in a row? So you are kind of stuck with me today, okay? Now, we're going to have some fun if you haven't already gathered that, but we are facing some stressful times, turbulent times in our country. I'm hoping I can give you some techniques that you can take home today and use to calm yourself down, to relax under pressure, and be a peak performer. I'll never forget the day that it happened. It was going to be the best year of my life. I was voted All-League as a catcher at my high school in Brecksville. And I was All-State as a football player. I got a football scholarship to Bowling Green as a wide receiver. On the way to Bowling Green, I'm sitting in a car with 4 other recruits. And I'm in the back seat with 2 big fellas. Kid on my left weighed about 340. He was going to play tackle at Bowling Green. The kid on my right was about 280. He was going to play guard. I was about 165 at the time. So I'm sitting between these 2 fellas in the back seat. Now, if you can picture this, we're sitting in the back seat of a Corvair. I know, we're really sandwiched in there. And if you can remember this, and you're going to give your age away, but I'm sitting on the hump. And I'm sitting between these fellas, and I got to scooch up in the seat a little bit because they're so big, and I had my head resting on the seat in front of me. When we got to exit 6 on the turnpike, there was a fellow that made some bad decisions at a party, had too much to drink, and thought he could drive. He went across the median strip going the wrong way on the turnpike. The patrolman later told me he probably was going about 85 miles an hour. He hit the car that I was riding in head on. I don't remember the accident at all. I think our brains are designed and in traumatic events we'll forget a lot of stuff just to keep our sanity. Maybe that's happened to you. I know it happened to me. But I remember waking up in that hospital with the nurses and doctors walking towards my bed. And they looked at me and said, son, we're sorry. You've broken your neck in 3 spots. You're never going to walk again. You're never going to play sports again. You're never going to coach sports again. You're never going to drive a car again. They had a whole list of all these things I'd never be able to do. About a month later, I tried to recall all the things they told me I'd never be able to do again, and I wrote them down in a list. I came up with about 21 things. That list is now on the wall in my office, and if you ever came to visit me, you'd see it's framed. And everything they told me that I'd never do has been marked off with a red X, because people don't know what's inside yourself. You don't know what's inside your employees or yourself right now. When you're under pressure, you can do amazing things, but you have to believe it in the first place. The belief is a big part. If you believe, we're putting a new program together. If you want to write this down, you can. It's a positive personal protection. A buddy of mine and I are putting together a program that will help people prepare for, live through, and I think more importantly, survive successfully afterwards. An active shooter incident, a parking lot attack, a fight somewhere, because all these things affect you permanently. And see, it's just one idea. If you have one, there's one idea that I learned at a hospital, turned my whole life around. I learned it from my night nurse. I'll never forget meeting my night nurse. The guy in the bed next to me looked at her walking in the room and said, "Hi, Sarge, how's your day going?" My night nurse's name was Sarge. Now, you're probably visualizing what a night nurse named Sarge looks like right now, and you're right. She was a very imposing figure. And she was the kind of woman that didn't take any crap from anybody. And guess what? Exactly the kind of person I needed in my life at that time. Because I had all kinds of whining to do and excuses to make. In fact, I kept asking myself the dreaded question. What's the dreaded question? Why me? Why did this happen to me? See, that's an endless loop question. You'll never get the solution that way. In fact, it takes you away from the solution and has you focus on the problem. It's better to ask yourself what and how questions. I'll prove it to you. I'm going to help your golf game right now. Let's say you're on the first tee, you're looking out at that fairway, and then you glance over to the right and you ask yourself, why do I always go in the lake on this hole? Well, think of the answers that your brain is giving you right now. And now ask yourself this question. What can I do to get the ball in the middle of the fairway? And look how different the answers that are coming into your mind are. They put you on the solution. Always ask yourself what and how questions. And the one idea that my night nurse taught me to turn my whole life around was how to visualize, believe it or not. I never was taught this in my life. She had me visualizing myself walking every day for the next 4 months. 4 months before it actually happened, she had me recline in my bed and she guided me through a visualization telling me exactly what was going to happen the day that I walked again. When that day finally came, when I took my first steps, it was just like she said, that first step, how nervous I was and how easy it turned out to be. The second step, even easier, and then something happened on the fourth step that she told me about for 4 months. I got a thing called Bambi legs. If you saw the movie, you know what I'm talking about. And it happened to me. I was able to take 3 more steps that first day, 7 altogether. The next day, I took 15. The next day, 28. The next day, all the way across the room. About 6 months later, I was able to jog and walk. 2 years later, I won a state championship in the state of Ohio in racquetball. Things that people told me I would never be able to do again. And in your life right now, if people are telling you you can't do something, let's get down to it. Let me help you show them how you can prove those people wrong. See, that one idea, and maybe you heard that one idea today, but you didn't recognize it. You weren't aware that it was going to occur to you. It only takes one idea. In my life, it was visualization. I don't know what it's going to be in your life. But one idea can turn your life around. I can prove that to you. When I was a kid, I wasn't very good at school. My grades were really bad. And in fact, when I was 14, they told me I probably had ADD. There was no H in it back then. It was simply ADD. Well, you know what they did to kids back then that had ADD? They put me in a classroom with 27 other kids that had ADD, thinking that was really going to help me out. All it did was kept me at the same level for the 2.5 years I was in that class, because I never found out what successful people like you were doing. And so it kept holding me back. Now, when I studied for a test, I would study all night long. That's not a good strategy, but I didn't know better at that time. When I woke up in the morning, my mom would quiz me as I had breakfast. She'd sit across the table, and everything she asked me, I got perfectly correct. And she'd say, "Son, you're going to do fine in that test. Don't worry." But as soon as I got to school and the teacher passed out the exam, I forgot everything that I studied the night before. I couldn't remember one answer. Does that happen to anybody else when you're taking tests? Well, when I talk at schools, and I talk at them all over the country, when I ask that question, 90% of the hands go up. Do you know there's a part of your brain that's responsible for your memory? It's called the hippocampus. And when you're under large amounts of stress, the hippocampus is destroyed one cell at a time. And therefore, the part of your brain that's going to help you remember answers is being destroyed while you're taking the test. This is why when you wake up in the morning and you're late for work and you're scrambling all over the house, you get to work, but you realize you forgot the report that you're supposed to bring, or you left your books at home, or you forgot a luncheon date you were supposed to go to, because part of your brain has been shutting down on you. And so I wrote this book. It was my one idea. I wrote this book called The Testing Zone that helps kids perform better when they're under pressure situations like taking a test. I wasn't prepared for this because the first person that bought my book was a guy named Tiger Woods. Now, I couldn't figure out why Tiger Woods would buy a book on testing skills. Well, in the book, we talk about some facts. Maybe you don't know these, but did you know that students that are right-eye dominant learn how to read faster and remember things better than students that are left-eye dominant? Because the right eye actually tracks from left to right and pulls the other eye with it. And that's how English is laid out. So I have a few techniques in the book that help kids get their eyes to relax when they're taking a long test, and to switch dominances. Well, Tiger uses the same techniques for his putting on the green. It's very powerful stuff, and you can use it almost anywhere. But I almost didn't finish writing the book. I almost quit, because it was taking too long, and I started to doubt my abilities. And then I met a young girl in Minneapolis. And this young girl, she never learned how to read, and she never learned how to write, and yet she published a book. And I'm going to show you right now how one idea can turn your life around. Because her book is called Everything That Men Know About Women. And it's empty. There's nothing in her book. This one idea changed her life because the first year she had this book out, she charges $3.50. Hey, if you live in Canada, you pay 6 1/4. We're not doing too bad here. And the first year she had the book out, she sold 1.2 million copies. Would that have changed your life? Would it change my life too? So why didn't we write the book? Well, think about this. You're walking down the street, you see one of your friends, and you say, hey, I'm going to write a book with nothing in it. What would they say to you? Yeah, you're crazy. That's stupid. Why would you want to do that? And most of us would have given up, not realizing that sometimes the craziest ideas are the best ideas. And if you don't believe that, I'm going to prove it to you. Back when I was a kid, there was a fellow that invented a thing called a pet rock. I'm serious. Mine came with a house, and mine came with a leash, with instructions on how to give the rock a drag on a Friday night, and how to clean it up. Do you know that fellow made $7.5 million selling stones to people? I'm sure you've had better ideas than that. And if you want to hear the rest of that story, it's kind of entertaining. Have you ever seen a show on TV called Andy of Mayberry? Remember the character named Otis? Barney would leave the cell door open for him on Friday night so that Otis could come in and sleep it off. He was the town drunk. Well, the guy that invented the pet rock was the Otis of his community. They cleaned him up out of the gutter every day. He had one idea his whole life that put all his kids through college. It bought him homes, bought him houses and cars, and it set the next generation up for success. So what's your idea? What's that idea that everybody's been telling you is never going to work? I'm going to encourage you to go for that idea. Now, I tell that story about Otis a lot. I got an email a few weeks ago from a guy, and he said, hey, Bruce, do you ever wonder why everybody in Mayberry is so happy? I couldn't come up with an answer, so I read his reply. It's because everybody in Mayberry is single. Aunt B's single, Andy's single, Miss Crump is single, the barber's single, I'm pretty single. Except Otis, and he is the town drunk. I thought that was kind of funny. I wanted to share that with you. But what does it take? What does it take to do amazing things? What does it take to break out of that shell we're trapped in? Well, you have to overcome one thing. And you all have this one thing. It's located in your brain. And psychologists call it the reticular activating system. I don't like to call it that. It's too long. I call it the little voice in the back of your mind. That way, most people know what I'm talking about. Now, you might not believe you have a little voice back there, but psychologists have proven that everybody has this little voice located in the reticular activating system that talks to us 50,000 times a day. That's how many thoughts the average person has in one day. But you never hear the voice until you get in a pressure pack situation. And then you can't shut the little sucker up. And it's telling you things like you're going to miss this shot. Don't ask her out. She's too beautiful. Don't buy that car. It's going to break down. Don't apply for that job. You're never going to get it. And pretty soon you become paralyzed by your thoughts like I was paralyzed by my broken neck. Now, if you don't believe me, let me ask you a question. How many of you, by show of hands, how many of you talk to yourselves? Whoa. A lot of people in Ashland talk to themselves. But I think one of you over here and one of you over here didn't raise your hand. And I understand that. Maybe you're new to the community. Maybe you're sitting by someone you like or someone you really respect, and you don't want them to think that you're wacko, so you're not going to raise your hand. But three things happen every time I ask this question, the same three things. Number one, when I ask people if they talk to themselves, they usually start giggling. And they go, well, you know, I did once a long time ago, I don't know, maybe. Second thing that happens, people start raising their hands, but they raise their hands in a very special way. They go like this. Don't want to be the only one. Third thing is simply amazing. The first time I noticed this, I was working with a football team. And I walked in a room with 60 guys, and I said, okay, fellas, who on this team talks to themselves? 2/3 of them raised their hand just like you did. But the other 1/3 of them, they were sitting there going like this. And the whole point is, we all do this. But let me show you something about your little voice. Your little voice, ever since you were a little kid, has been conditioned to not tell you the truth about yourself. It lies to you about your ability. Now I'm going to prove this to you. I'm going to prove that you have a voice, and I'm going to prove that it lies to you. In order to do this, I need your help. And all I need you to do is to guarantee me that while we do this demonstration, you're going to give me everything you've got. It's only going to take 20 seconds. Can you give me 100% for just 20 seconds? Can you do that?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's do that again. Okay, this time, pretend like you like me. All right, just act like you like me. And when I count to three, I want you to say yes as loud as you can. Ready? One, two, three.
Yes!
Now you see the difference? That's 100%. So here we go. I'm going to prove your voice lies to you. I want you to take your left hand and raise it above your head. Get it up in the air. As high as you can get it. Okay? As high as it will go. Good job. That's great. Now, is that as high as it goes here, young lady? Well, that's better. Okay, good. That as high as it goes back there? Good. That as high as it goes? Great job. Now that your hand is up as high as it can go, I want you to take and raise it just 1/4 inch higher. Go for it. 1/4 inch. Now, put your hands down. I'm sure you all saw that. I just asked you to give me 100%. You said, yeah. Then I asked you 3 times, is your hand as high as it'll go? And you sat there going, uh-huh. And then I said, go 1/4 inch higher, what'd y'all do? You did it. The little voice just lied. Well, what can we do to get the voice to be on our side? Let me give you a few techniques that you can take and use right now today at work. Number one, always remember one thing about life, and I learned this the hard way, I broke my neck. Always remember this. What time is it? Anybody know? Okay, well, I don't know if you can see my watch from where you're sitting, but my watch is empty. There's nothing in it. And people always look at me and go, why do you wear that crazy watch with nothing in it? Well, there's 2 reasons. Number one, it was really cheap. And number two, it reminds me of the only moment that I can do anything about in my life. What is that? It's right now. Do you know, if you really research this, you'll find out that this is the only moment in your life that actually exists. The rest of it's already over, or it hasn't happened yet. And at Stanford University, they took the research so far that they found out that the average person in our country spends 56 minutes out of every hour worrying about what's going to happen in the future and regretting things they did in the past. Only 4 minutes in the now. Is it any wonder we don't have more accidents if we're not focused on this moment, which is the only moment we can do anything about? This is why I love setting goals, because when you set a goal, you bring the future into the now where you can do something about it. I got to tell you, though, the younger you are, the harder it is to stay in the now. We messed up. My generation messed up. We allowed young people to see threatful and violent things way before their brains were ready and allowed them to hear them on the radio, in music, in newscasts before their brains were ready. Eric Jensen has a great book on brain development. The prefrontal lobe is the last part of your brain to be developed. That's where you make all your good decisions from. It's taken a lot longer to develop that part of the brain now because of the threat and violence in a person's life. I had no idea about this until I was taking my daughter down to Columbus, Ohio. And it was her birthday, and she had 11 of her friends in the back of the van. And we're heading to the Polaris Amphitheater to see a group called NSYNC. Hey, I heard they're coming back, and I'm going, and I hope Justin's with them because he was amazing. But on the way down there, my daughter gave me a CD, and she says, Dad, can you put this CD in? Jessica wants to hear track number 5. I said, sure, honey, it looks okay to me. And I always did like M&Ms. But I found an M&M. I'm speaking as a father now. I found an M&M that I didn't care for. There was something wrong with a 52-year-old man driving a truckload of young ladies down to Columbus, Ohio with that kind of language coming out of the speakers. And then when I started to visualize what this guy was talking about, and I thought the girls were seeing the same thing, that CD had to go, and it did. And I'm not sure if you realize it. It's like that book they wrote, when you put a frog in boiling water, it jumps out. But if you let it stay in the pot, you gradually heat the water up by supper time, you get frog legs. And that's what happened to us. We're submerged in this evil stuff now. It's everywhere you go. It's even in my favorite kind of music. I love country music. But there's some bad country out there. Did anybody read this article in Newsweek a few weeks ago? They were doing some research on country music, and you know what happens when you sing country music backwards? You sober up, you get a job, your wife comes back, you get a new pickup truck, and your dog finds its way back home. No, I'm just kidding. That's a joke, okay? But that leads me to point number 2. Staying in the now, really important. Number two, let's not focus on the bad stuff. I know what's happening all around us. There's also some great stuff happening in your life every day. Before you go to sleep at night, make a list of the things you are blessed with today. Keep the list going. Just three a day is good. After 1 week, you've got 21 things. After 2 weeks, you start realizing, hey, my life's not so bad after all. Just make the list. A better way to do it is to start using affirmations. If you don't know what an affirmation is a positive statement that you say over and over about yourself. It's always done in first person, present tense, like it's already happening to you. I'll give you an example. My favorite affirmation is this. I am always calm and confident under pressure. I am always calm and confident under pressure. Now, if you notice, there's two different body languages and two different voice inflections. Because when you change your body language, different parts of the brain are firing off and storing the information. And I want to get the whole thing involved. But people always laugh at me and they go, come on. Are you telling me that by saying those really nice, mamby-pamby things, that you're going to change your life? No, you change your actions. If you don't believe you can change the way you think and feel by repeating good things over and over, let me prove that you're wrong. Has anybody here ever been to Disney World before? Well, then you proved you were wrong. Because if you're like me, when I go to Disney World, the first place I'm heading to is the Magic Kingdom. And I got to tell you, I always take the boat over. Because the horizon creeps up on you a little bit at a time, and the suspense builds gradually. And I gotta confess to you, I get chills all over my body when I first see Cinderella's castle. And I go through Cinderella's castle, take a quick left, second right on the right, I go in there. And that ride is called It's a Small World. Has anybody ever been in that ride before? Then you tell me, when you get off that ride, what song are you humming for the next 3 hours walking around Disney World? And your heads are going like that, and you can't stop them because that's what you saw and heard. Well, guess what? That's how affirmations work. They come back into your mind when you least expect them to be there. It's like advertising yourself to yourself. Do you think advertising works? Then why don't you have your own advertisement? And you know what? An affirmation can be your advertisement. If you want to see how powerful advertising is, finish this sentence for me. Plop, plop, fizz, fizz. What a relief it is. Got news for you. That advertisement has not been heard in its entirety for over 25 years. And yet people still remember. How about this one? How do you spell relief? R-O-L-A-I-D-S. That one hasn't been heard for 14 years, but you still remember. The other day I was speaking at the Cleveland Clinic and I was talking to doctors and nurses. I asked them, how do you spell relief? And they said, F-A-R-T. But we had a good time with that group. They were a lot of fun. And see, right now you're laughing and you're smiling. I really believe in being positive, but I don't have much time up here today, so I really want to make sure that you get this. Be as positive as you can. And if you don't believe in being positive, watch what happens when you're negative. Has anybody ever said to you, never say the word can't, because you can do anything. Did you ever hear that? Yeah, and then 10 minutes later, what word do you say? Can't. Now, why would you say that word when everybody told you not to? Because they never told you or showed you why. I'm going to show you why right now. Because those are all negative contractions. Can't, wouldn't, couldn't, shouldn't, won't. They're negative contractions. Every time you use a negative contraction, your performance goes right out the window, and I'm going to prove it to you. The most powerful word in our language happens to be a negative contraction. You've already used it about 20 times today, and you've got 15 more times left. And every time you use this word with your kids, teamworks, or coworkers, they go out and do the exact opposite thing that you want them to do. Let me show you what the word is, but I need your help. And all I need you to do is guarantee me that you're going to do exactly what I asked you to do for 10 seconds. And when the 10 seconds is up, you tell me what the word is. Are you ready? As quick as you can, put your hand up. Put your hand down. Put your hand up. Put your hand down. Put your hand up. Okay, last thing. Pay attention. Don't put your hand up. Don't put your hand up. I said don't put, okay, put your hands down. See, in this day and age, our instructions have to be precise. What was the word? Don't just confuse you. It made you think. Because your brain thinks in pictures and it can't see what a don't is, so it lets it go right through. So when I said don't put your hand up, what's your brain here? Put your hand up. That's why some of you are sitting there going, it already is up. Because that's what your brain was hearing. If you don't believe this works, next time you're playing golf and you're on the first green, look at the person that's putting and say, hey, don't leave this one short. It's so funny what happens next. Those balls never make it to the hole. Now, we talked a lot about what it takes to believe in yourself, what it takes to be positive, and you're probably wondering, how can I use this in my everyday life? Do I have 1 minute? Okay, I'll show you one thing that will help you use it in your everyday life. And I call this the secret of life, actually. The secret of life. What's the secret of life? Let me show you. I brought them with me today. I have them right here. Here they are, the secrets of life. Now, some of you are laughing. You're going, that can't be the secrets of life. That's just your book and some CDs. You're right. But I'm going to use these to show you what the secret is. This is my book, The Testing Zone. This is my CD, Follow Your Dreams. It's the 4 things about life that I learned that allowed me to walk again when everybody said it wasn't going to happen. My newest one is for people like me with a short attention span. There's 58 one-minute messages. It's called The Monday Motivator. You listen to it on Monday. You do the homework for a week. Come back next morning, Monday, listen to number 2. But by that time, you've got a success trait embedded in your mind. Be careful with number 20. Number 20 is all about love. And the homework for that week is, before you go into work, you give your significant other a 20-second kiss. Now, we have people that don't make it to work on Monday and Tuesday, and that week's a But the secret is this. You can get these online. I wouldn't suggest that, because with the postage, it's over $60 now. I have them available today, and I'll be waiting until the end of the meeting, and I'll probably stand around here somewhere. If you wanted all 3 of them, you can have all 3 for 20, okay? That's a good deal, but that's not the secret. The secret is this. You can buy them online, you can have them today, but if you really want them, this set right here doesn't cost a dime. It's free. All you have to do is come take it, and it doesn't cost you anything. It's free for the person that comes up to get it. Let's give him a hand. The attitude is called G-O-Y-A. Goya. Get off your attitude. And go for it. Who in this room besides Troy, who wishes they'd got those? Anybody wish they'd got those? Lady in the back, what's your name?
Jean Bratton.
Jean?
Yep.
You really wish you'd got those?
Yes, I do.
Well, you are geographically challenged here, Jean, okay? But Jean, I like you. You've been smiling. You laughed at my jokes. And I want to make sure this never happens to you again. So I got something for you in closing. Gene, this is for you. If you take and wear this everywhere you go, it'll remind you that you got to get off your attitude and go for it, okay? So you can have this, Gene. I want to thank you for having me come here. And I'm sorry it was so quick. If you want more information, I have business cards up here. You can certainly get one of those. I'll have my products if you want this. You don't have to do that. Let's hear it for Gene. And I want to thank the Safety Council for calling me 4 times to come speak at this meeting. Thank you so much, everybody.